not to mention new recordings.
The most important thing is that we never change the members.
When you're together for so long, you know, you sometimes do get on each other's nerves.
It's like being married in a way.
That's the bit I enjoyed most, you know.
In fact, it lasts longer.
That may change, but at the moment, you know.
We used to take it very seriously.
Good. Well, I hope so.
Too seriously.
Yes, we do have a few arguments over that one as well.
We argue very badly sometimes.
Four cocks fighting.
I'm quite shocked, actually.
Oh, it's getting nice, this.
Oh, yeah.
Not two of us are the same.
But it was all ourselves.
We've always been stronger together.
Queen is a lot better than any one of us.
We've learned to accept each other instinctively.
And we can always come back to Queen, like coming back to Mother.
But let's go back to the very beginning, rewinding history from Nebworth to Smile.
I don't want to sleep with you. I don't need the passion to. I don't want a stormy affair. Make me feel my life is heading somewhere. All I want is the comfort and care. Just to know that my woman gives me sweet mother love.
It all started with Brian May and Roger Taylor's band Smile, seen here at the Royal Albert Hall, the first time they were ever filmed.
It's at the Albert Hall, of course. Smile was really a semi-pro outfit. We hadn't really made the big jump to go professional. I guess we couldn't because we were all still at college.
Children learn to wing, she strung their beats, but sorry she was the one.
I used to go and see people at the Marquee, see groups at the Marquee, and think, now how do you get to that situation? And the answer was that people want to book you if they've heard of you, if you've made a record or something like that. How do you get to make records? Well, you get to make records because if you've played at places like the Marquee where people notice you. So how do you get in?
I had gone for a few interviews, audition. They're always rather depressing affairs, you know, you sort of get 80 drum kits in a line. And...
She won a heart, the art she loves, painting pictures for free. When she was done, she hung them up for all the children.
We'd formed Queen before, I mean, I can say this, you know, now, before sort of David Bowie had done anything.
I'm not sure. I'm really not sure.
I mean, you know, there was a long sort of gap between actually forming Queen and actually having a recording contract.
With their record deal and first two albums, Queen finally vaulted into the public domain.
From the skies, I command your very souls, you unbelievers. Before me, what is wild and empty's arrive.
I heard from a friend that they were looking for the bass guitarist to join their group. I got myself introduced to them and said I'd be interested. And so basically I went along for an audition.
I'll take you to the seven seas of rap.
Fred here, no. Typical.
Righto.
The impressive, considered studio work which defined Queen's identity over the first few albums was equaled only by the excitement of their live performances.
Have you enjoyed it tonight, Rudd?
Oh, yeah, fine. It was all right, you know.
Thank you. The Nasty Queenies are back.
So decorous name, the illuminations, but I'm not the same. So what's the goal, Mr.
I don't think any Queen song was ever just written like to be a hit.
I remember the beginnings very well because we had incredible belief in ourselves, you know. I mean, quite blind and ridiculous belief in some ways, but we did have this kind of belief that we could do anything that anyone else could do. You make me live
now, honey. I was caught up in, you know, being successful and being a star and all that, and I thought, this is the way a star behaves or whatever. And now I don't give a damn. And I ever had been with
you such a long time. You're my sunshine. Like all bands, we wanted to be successful, and we went out and worked at it. Spread your wings
and fly away. As you get older, you just change naturally because you have more experience. So you're never going to be a silly teenager again, although sometimes, you know, you feel like one. Fly away,
far away. It's a growth process, you know, people grow up, and, I mean, after 10 or 12 years, I think you have to be seen to be growing up, and the people that have grown up with you can't suddenly say, oh, my God, he's still got long hair, and he's still wearing black fingernails, and he's wearing a lady's blouse. I mean, it's ridiculous. I mean, I would feel ridiculous.
I looked ridiculous then, but it worked.
During the career of the band, we started off playing small audiences, so we slowly built up, you know, and then we suddenly started playing 10,000, whatever, in America, then 15, and then it was only in the 80s that we started really doing some of these big festivals. You don't waste no time at all. Don't hear the bell, but you answer the call. You ask to what's wrong.
Live Aid was probably our favourite day.
Live Aid was Freddie's moment, you know. He definitely pulled something special out of that crowd. I guess we helped, you know. But more than anything, it was Freddie, I think. You have to give him that.
Yeah! Do it! Live Aid! Sing it again! We will
rock you. Freddie was very, you know, animated and very good performer and worked the audience very well. So yes, they were an ideal stadium rock band and enjoyed doing things on a grand scale.
The Magic Tour of 1986, which was to be their last ever, made history, instigating the first major stadium show behind the Iron Curtain in Budapest and culminated in two triumphant shows at Wembley.
The bigger the better. All we hear is
Radio Gaga. But that wasn't enough. 120,000 people packed a quickly arranged open-air show.
I was just really happy that the Nebworth show happened the way it did because it was never planned on the tour to start off with. You know, Wembley was supposed to be the last show, etc. And, you know, Wembley went so fast and we couldn't get another Wembley. So I went to the band and said, look, you know, what about doing Nebworth? And they said, well, can you guarantee it's going to sell out? Or I said, yeah, it'll sell out. Famous last words. And it did. Radio was to you.
They've sold more than 80 million albums, they've played before more than 6 million people, and they've had 16 consecutive hits. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, the top band of the 80s are Queen. Thank you.
Thank you. I've been delegated by the boys to say a couple of words. I'd just like to say, after all these years, contrary to what you may think, we do very much appreciate that you still appreciate us. And we hope to be performing some more miracles for you very soon in 1990 and beyond. Thank you very much.
Oh,
by the end of the 80s, Queen had indelibly established their three-prong reputation as a globally successful live act, studio craftsman with over 100 million records sold by 89, and pioneering video artist.
Final Studios, 35th video.
Form of entertainment.
Different ideas.
There's bits of all of us in it.
Visual theatrics.
I mean, I can't say it's been easy.
In a funny way, they're just part of my life.
Terrific. A storyboard.
Become somebody else.
Extravagant.
I do quite a lot of it.
Now!
Throughout their career, Queen were fully involved in the conceptualizing of their videos, exploring a variety of styles that were always determined by the mood and sentiment of the song in question.
I wake up, feel just fine. Your face fills my mind.
He's listening to the song, you know, it had this suggestion of like an express train. And then I think Freddie and I came up with the idea of having a train and calling it the Miracle Express.
If I could only reach you, if I could make you smile, if I could only reach you, that would really be a breakthrough. That falls in Sahara Desert says it all, it's a miracle.
In the Miracle video, this conceptualizing process led to the daring notion of having young lookalikes portraying the teen Queen protagonists, but the band themselves only joining in for a brief cameo appearance at the finale.
We were prepared for it to be good, but we were still quite shocked and stunned at how good these guys were, the young guys. Fantastic, yeah.
I think it was Freddie's idea to send them out on tour instead of us.
A nationwide search was launched for a substitute teen Queen. These rare casting tapes show the auditions for young pretenders to the Queen throne. Over 100 kids thought they were born to play their heroes. Only four of them made it.
Trying to imitate him, it was so difficult at first. But his moves, if you try and copy his moves, then they do get easier the more you do it. And I mean, they're really sort of outrageous moves he does, so, I mean, I'm an outrageous person, I suppose. I don't know, even when I left the set, I was still Freddie Mercury for them 2 days. It was just like, I'd been working as Freddie through the auditions and on the stage. So when I left, you know, it was just like natural that I was still Freddie Mercury.
The one thing we're all waiting for is peace on earth.
In truth, the kids were doing no more than Freddie himself had always done.
The miracle!
That's the stuff I do. It's pretending. It's like acting, you know. So you go on stage and I pretend to be a macho man and all that. And then in my videos, you know, you go through all the different characters and then you're pretending.
The Slightly Mad video was the last to feature significant creative input from Freddie. Creating an artistic persona that proved to be one of his most brilliant video performances, he distracted everyone, including himself, from his own ailments.
You won't take it?
No, I can you stroke him, yeah?
Yeah, get him a bit of man.
And ended up being upstaged by a penguin.
There.
What's he doing?
Oh, baby, baby.
Roger, what did you do?
When the outside temperature rises and the meaning is oh so clear, 1001 yellow daffodils.
This unique footage shows Freddie in action, co-directing his colleagues.
I'm going to sit down here next to Roger, who's sitting here. So Roger, sit here.
Roger. I'm going slightly mad. I'm going slightly mad. It finally happened.
Finally.
Happened.
Really,
happened.
Oh, yes, like that. Okay, yeah. And then you can just sit down.
Finally happened. Finally happened.
It's a sort of storyboard for that one.
Right.
Once we get it, and do whatever you want.
I'm going slightly mad. I'm going slightly mad. It finally happened. It finally happened. Oh yes, it finally happened.
The character was a good piece of camouflage. At the same time as being this sort of slightly leerish, slightly no coward type of humour in it, and the sort of wild haired character with the heavy makeup and the black and white all did help to hide the fact that Freddie was in fact pretty ill at that point.
I'm slightly mad, just very slightly mad.
There you have it. End of session.
Freddie performed again, appearing on camera for the very last time for the Days of Our Lives video in autumn 91, weeks before his untimely demise. Despite being racked with crippling pain, he was a professional to the very end, giving his best whenever the camera was rolling, never asking for special considerations or letting anyone around him realize just how ill he was.
We just live for fun. Sometimes it seems like lately, I just don't know. Rest of my life's been just a show.
So with Days of Our Lives, there are lots of things in there which, to us looking at it now, are completely about Freddie saying goodbye in a way.
Those were the days of our lives. Yeah.
Maybe it was in the lap of the gods, and no coincidence at all, that the last words Freddie ever uttered on film were, "I still love you." Maybe he sensed what was to come and wanted this to be a personal message of farewell and thanks to the fans. Just maybe.
But I look, but I find.
I would imagine that that was probably going through his mind, you know, this is a nice line to go out on.
I still love you.
Feel very lucky that we had those fantastic times.
We were together for most of my adult life, you know, since I was not much more than 20, I was doing stuff with Freddie. And it's really like losing a brother.
The 45-year-old lead singer of Queen died peacefully at his home in London.
Fans and friends in paying tribute to the singer Freddie Mercury, who died late last night from AIDS.
At midnight, it was announced that Freddie Mercury had died peacefully at his London home.
Dedicated to their lead singer, Freddie Mercury, who died last night of AIDS.
He died on Sunday after revealing that he was suffering from AIDS.
45-year-old Queen singer who died yesterday, a bronchial pneumonia brought on by AIDS.
His spokesman said he died peacefully last night at his West London home.
Meanwhile, fans from across the country are expected to come here to Freddie Mercury's home to pay their tributes to a man regarded as one of the best in the business.
After he died, I did all the arrangements for it, the funeral, because we'd spent so many years making him look presentable before he left the house. You know, making sure that his tie was straight, making sure he looked so good, that it was the last thing that I could do for his last leaving, was just to make everything as perfect as possibly could.
Ooh, take my breath away.
C'est la vie. Loving person. How about that?
Look into my eyes and you'll see I'm the only one. You've captured my love, stolen my heart, changed my life.
If I had to do it all over again, yes, why not? Why not? I do it slightly differently.
Every time you make a move, you destroy my mind. And the way you touch, I lose control and shiver deep inside. You take my breath away.
While accepting a posthumous award for Freddie's lifetime achievements, Roger announces the Freddie Mercury tribute concert. 72,000 tickets sold out in 2 hours.
Roger has been working very hard, and Roger has a special announcement to make.
Yeah, we hope that a lot of you will be able to join us on April the 20th at Wembley Stadium for a celebration of Freddie's life and career. A lot of friends are coming, and you're all welcome.
It started off so well. Said we made a perfect pair.
And famous friends came by the busload.
Your glory and your love, how I loved you, how I cried. Years of care and loyalty. But a sham it seems. Years will I will end till I love you till I die.
My sort of thought was to do something that would achieve two aims at once and try and get some good out of the situation.
It's not Queen. I don't think it's Queen. It's the three of us and a lot of other people combining to do something with the Queen catalogue. And more specifically, you know, angled towards Freddie's part of it, you know.
This particular point, I think it's... I think by now so many of us have actually had friends, or maybe in some cases members of families have been struck down by it. And I think this is as well as probably the most... just the greatest place to create an explosion of awareness for this particular situation.
That burns a building down, splits a family in two, puts people on streets.
Taking my bow.
Did I find it? Oh my God. And my curtain calls. You brought me payment, fortune, everything old. And I thank you all, my love.
Awesome, getting up there and playing together. The reason that we were there and the whole benefit and even though it, you know, a result of such a tragic thing that happened with Freddie, it made such a difference to the whole rock and roll audience, because I think that was one of the main things we tried to ignore was the AIDS thing. And it really brought everybody together. And there was a really wonderful vibe between us and the whole audience.
He was a sweet guy, yeah, great voice. And a tribute and testament to him, which a lot of people won't click and understand on the day, is that a lot of people are changing the keys to these songs because they just can't do a Freddie.
It should be a celebration. Freddie wouldn't have wanted it any other way, I'm sure.
Nothing really matters to me.
It's going to be a very emotional day for them. An emotional day for the audience and the people who are singing these songs, but for the band, it's kind of like the end, closing a chapter of a book, so they're going to feel very, very strange, I think. I feel for them today.
Who wants to live forever?
My actual first choice was Who Wants to Live Forever. You know, because it was in a film, Highlander, right? And I remember when I first heard it, it was one of the few songs that brought tears to my eyes. It's a really emotional song. And so I thought, oh, I'd love to sing that. But then I tried to sing it and I thought, Jesus, I can't sing this. Do you know what I mean? It's going to be the end of my career.
Shall we try it then?
You're taking all the sunshine away, making out like your mainline.
I knew that.
Cause you're a cool cat, tapping on the toe with a new hat. Ooh, just cruising, driving along with the swing king, feeling the beat of my heart.
As he would have said, darling, Wembley Stadium, are you sure it's big enough?
Ayo!
The real stars of that evening were the fans, who sang along, despite Freddie only being there on the video wall, with a degree of emotion that made him seem present in more than just spirit.
All right!
This concert also used its worldwide telecast audience of 1 billion viewers as a platform to generate AIDS awareness.
We are here to celebrate the life of Freddie Mercury. We are here also to tell the whole world that he, like others we have lost to AIDS, died before his time.
Each morning I get a rise out here. Can't let me stand on my feet. Take a look in the mirror and I cry. Lord, what are you doing to me? I spent all my years in believing you, but I just
George Michael gave a brilliant performance at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert, which was later released on the 5 Live EP, a world smash in aid of the Mercury Phoenix Trust. The outstanding performance gave rise to wild rumors of George Michael and Queen coming together to form a new lineup with him as a singer.
When I think of Freddie, I think of everything that he gave me in terms of craft. And just to sing those songs was especially somebody to love, with really an outrageous feeling.
Somebody love.
probably the proudest moment for me of my career, because it was me living out a childhood fantasy, I suppose.
Made some great records.
Alarming lapses of taste.
But musically, they're so good.
They meant everything to me.
It's a perfect band, really.
It represents that whole spirit of rock and roll.
Very majestic.
Most important figures in rock and roll.
Molto preciso.
It's extraordinary.
Very godlike.
A true love for music.
Mad as a hatter.
Real rock stars.
Bring something into people's lives.
Awesome.
Great voice.
Fabulous.
Rock. Extravagances.
That's pretty outrageous.
These guys can be around forever.
Living life to the full.
If there is such a thing as ever.
Pure champions.
From Guns N' Roses to Lisa Stansfield, Extreme to Liza Minnelli, Metallica to Seal, everyone put their egos on the back burner in the spirit of the occasion, allowing Freddie, despite his absence, to take center stage at the event.
In working with these other people, I know for a fact that Freddie would have been excited to be working with them, you know, and he, if he's looking on up there, you know, I know that he's into it. I know he's excited. I know he's up.
There would only be one short period of time in which the time would be right. And the time would be right for two reasons. One, for Freddie, and two would be to, in effect, to capitalize on his death and to make some, bring some good out of it by creating a greater awareness of the AIDS danger.
The spirit of the concert carried over into the foundation of the Freddie Mercury Phoenix Trust.
The people who had organized the concert wanted to have more control on what happened to the money that was made from the concert. And so we founded the Mercury Phoenix Trust in the summer, just after the tribute concert.
When we come together, we feel at home.
We have funded mainly charities that have projects that help the people who are suffering directly.
Sing your song. When we go back home, we feel lonely, but when we come together, we feel at home, because we dance, discuss, and enjoy ourselves. Why don't we...
In all, I would say that Queen has been responsible for over £3.5 million of money going to AIDS help.
Queen's music lives on in many ways, most conspicuously at the fan club conventions, where their work is celebrated without the band even being present.
I ask you to be my Clementine.
The first one was about 500, and this one is 2,000.
Welcome to Southport, the Queen's 10th year convention.
Don't stop me. Activities range from the aerobic sessions that were going on this morning, hundreds of people doing this awful fitness stuff. We have a fancy dress.
Behaviour that might appear obsessive to the outside world often has its roots in the profound bond the fans still feel with Freddie.
My name's Lawrence Holland, I'm 26. I usually dress up every year. When he died, it was like losing a friend. It was really weird. And I suppose that's why I like dressing up, because for me it's like... I don't know, it's like... It's keeping him alive in a way. Slightly mad. He wore quite a lot of heavy makeup, and it's quite tricky to try and get that that right and the right colour and everything, and also the wig, because he wore a wig in that video, so it's quite sort of difficult to sort of get that as well. But I think, keep your fingers crossed, it should all look good tonight.
I'm going slightly mad. I'm going slightly mad.
We had a run of songs which became sports anthems.
We are the champions. We are the champions.
Queen's music also enjoys a life of its own in the sporting arena, uniting people in the triumph and glory of the game.
A lot of our biggest success has been stuff which brings people together. It's related to that feeling you get at football matches, I think. But the difference is that in a rock concert, everyone's on the same side, which is rather nice.
When we first went to America, I suppose, like most people, it was all big and it was all new and it was all very exciting.
Throughout the 70s, Queen enjoyed phenomenal success in America, selling out prestige venues like Madison Square Gardens and racking up a string of number one records, culminating with Another One Bites the Dust, which sold 4.5 million singles in the US alone.
When we were having a lot of success there, I don't think we were under any illusions, because it had taken quite a while to get there, you know. And really, when we became less popular in America through the 80s, we hardly noticed, because in fact we were spending most of our time outside America.
Most important of all, my recollection, unquestionably, is that they were specially disadvantaged, I think, in that they didn't tour the United States.
We've really ignored America for quite a while. I think the last time we toured in America was 1982.
Pressure pushing down on me, pressing down on you, no man is broke. Under pressure that burns a building down, splits a family in two, pushing people on streets.
It became a sort of chicken and egg situation, which was that Freddie didn't want to go back to America until he felt that it would be a successful tour. He didn't want to go back to work to make it successful. And therefore, we absolutely adopted the attitude that until we had a major record, there would be no touring of America. The major record didn't come, and therefore the tours didn't come either.
I think we'll go with a little Bohemian Rhapsody, gentlemen.
Out of the blue came the Paramount film Wayne's World with Bohemian Rhapsody and the very famous sequence in the car.
Good call.
There are a few things in my life that I'll never forget from adolescence, and one is hanging out at the airport and watching airplanes land, playing road hockey, when Team Canada beat the Soviet Union in 1972 in a hockey series, and the first time I heard Bohemian Rhapsody.
Galileo.
I was in my brother's Toyota Corolla that had exhaust problems.
Galileo.
Galileo.
And Bohemian Rhapsody came on the radio, and we were like, what the hell is this? I mean, there's like, it's cod opera.
Bismillah. We will not let you go.
And heavy metal. I remember having a stiff neck for 3 weeks from the gang, 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 gang.
So you think you can stop me and split my eye?
The record company had put clips of Wayne's World in the video.
Anyway the wind blows doesn't really matter to me.
And I just thought, well, they're going to hate us.
To me.
you know, we've just whizzed on a Picasso. I asked the record company guy, I said, can you just explain to them that, you know, we didn't have anything, I didn't know, and if you're, I'm sorry. And then I got a letter from Queen saying, thank you so much. Mama, hey, thank you for using our song. Thank you for using our song.
Didn't mean to make you cry.
More like, thank you for letting us even touch the hem of your garment. Anyway, the wind blows doesn't really matter to me, which is totally the theme of the movie.
Nothing really matters. Nothing really matters to me.
It wasn't just one single or two albums that took off here. You had an explosive interest in a whole body of work that four extremely talented, extraordinarily intelligent and really gifted people and musicians brought to their audiences all over the world, that it was triggered off by that one film.
The Mountain Studios, owned by Queen in Montreux, Switzerland, played an important part in the band's history. For them, it was like recording in their own living room.
Someone like Roger O'Brien would come in with a pretty definite idea, lyrically. They'd already written the lyrics and a few chords. Well, the whole band would then get together and rearrange it and transform it into that, or play it live, any different ways of doing it. Then the other way would be a complete jam session and madness in the studio, like Under Pressure, for instance, that was done here.
And this room was to attain even greater significance as the studio in which the band recorded their last songs ever together with Freddie Mercury. By this point, Freddie could sense that the path of his life was coming full circle, and this is reflected in some of those last Queen songs.
I don't need the passion to I don't want a stormy affair to make me feel my life is heading somewhere.
Freddie, I think when he first came here, thought it was probably the most boring place on earth.
Yeah, that's right.
And it's funny how gradually, over the next 12 years, Freddie himself fell in love with Montreux and began to appreciate the real special charm of this place.
This could be heaven. In these days of cool reflection, you come to me, and everything seems alright.
By the time we were doing these other tracks after Innuendo, we'd had the discussion and we knew that we were totally on borrowed time because Freddie had been told that he wouldn't even make it to that point. So, our plan was just going there whenever Freddie felt well enough. We just lived there for a while, so we were always at the end of a phone. Freddie would say, I can come in today for a few hours. And what we would do would be just make the best use we could of him. You know, that's what he asked. He said, you know, just get me to sing anything you can. You know, write me anything, and I'll sing it, and I'll give you as much material as I can.
Too much love will kill you every time. I'm just the shadow of the man I used to be, and it seems like there's no way out of this bar. I used to bring you sunshine. Now all I ever do is bring you down.
He was fairly lighthearted about it, you know, and said, yeah, I'll do anything I can, you know, just write me more words, and so we did. and a few of those things you will hear. And of course, you never knew what was going to be the last bit. You never knew. You just did another bit and another bit and another bit. And we had some great times. We really did.
The night's drawing. There's a silky moon up in the sky.
No matter what physical condition Freddie was in, his musical genius had never been sharper. And Queen recorded not only the most personal album of their entire career, but possibly also the finest.
What a super feeling! Am I dreaming? Am I dreaming? Whoa, 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 whoa! So quiet and peaceful, tranquil and blissful. Magic in the air. What a truly magnificent view. A breathtaking scene.
Dreams of the world in the palm of your hand.
You're the last person I'm talking to, so you probably get the best interview, darling, don't I?
I don't want to change the world.
To me, happiness is the most important thing. And if I'm happy, then it shows in my work.
In the end, all the mistakes and all the excuses are down to me. I'd like to feel that I'm just being my honest self. And as far as I'm concerned, I mean, I just want to pack in as much of life and fun, having a good time, as much as I can within the years I have. This could be heaven. Well, there you are, you have it on tape. Use it. Well, that's the nearest I've come to a lot of passion in terms of interviews. How much more have you got now? Come on, I'm getting bored.
In these days of cool reflection, you come to me, and everything seems alright. In these days of cold affections, you sit by me, and everything's fine. Yeah, this could be heaven for everyone. This world could be fair. This world could be fun. This should be love for everyone. This world should be free. This world could be one. We should bring love to our daughters and sons. Love, 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 love. This could be heaven for
forever.